Hello there. Are you tired of using tokenizers for your language transformers? Highly likely you're not, because usually these lines from the Hugging Face library do the heavy lifting for you, so you usually do not care about tokenization. But tokenization is a pre-processing step, therefore it is rigid and not adapted to your application nor your data. But wait no more! Charformer is here, enabling end-to-end language transformers that do not require tokenization anymore. Miss Coffee Bean, are we cool? You know what happened in our last video. And I only wanted to know if we're okay now. Yes? Cool. Tokenization is that part in pre-processing that is done to text before throwing it into your favorite language model, say BERT. It is a pre-processing step, so it is independent of the later training process, but it's crucial for most transformers. Without tokenization, each word of the English vocabulary would have to be assigned a unique vector on the input side, and when predicting the masked word in the output, the choice would have to consider the whole vocabulary. And if you believe that the English vocabulary that one can find in a dictionary is already huge, think about how it can grow even faster with all words that are not in a dictionary, like compound words created on the fly by someone as a stylistic figure, or all possible typos, right? A mistyped word is also a word and should have a way to be processed by a language model. This is where tokenization comes in to at least partially solve this problem by creating a smaller vocabulary of word building blocks. This hopes to cover as much of the dictionary as possible, including unexpected words. Therefore, tokenizers first segment the sentence into words, harder for some languages than for others. I'm looking at you, Chinese, Thai, and Korean, because you do not have white space separation. Then the words are parsed into subwords, so that even though supposedly the dictionary does not have the word pre-processing in it, and therefore no vector representation to associate with it, the tokenizer can divide the word into pre and processing, supposing that pre and processing are already in the vocabulary and have a vector association. And this works great in very regular kinds of words that can be decomposed into known blocks, but does not solve the problem of noisy text, full of typos where the possibilities of mistyping are so many that a fallback to a known subword is either impossible or leads to misunderstandings. So tokenization being so rigid can become a problem, an even bigger one when working with multiple languages where the out-of-vocabulary problem becomes even greater with every additional language the model has to handle. Even more, the downside of tokenization is that on downstream applications, you are kind of forced to use the same tokenizer as the model was trained with, because the trained model is very much dependent on the tokenization it is used to. Even though your task might benefit from other tokenizations, you now must stick with the initial ones. No, you're not allowed to see other tokenizers, Miss Coffee Bean. Here is where the Charformer comes to save the day. What if you would have a completely end-to-end language transformer that does not require this tokenization pre-processing step and takes the data in as is, in characters, and dynamically computes fitting representations for your task and data on the fly? But Miss Coffee Bean wants to know, why do we need a Charformer in the first place? What if we would take in the characters, give them all an initial vector representation, and throw them like that into the transformer, and boom, I mean, problem solved. Well, Miss Coffee Bean, it is not that easy. On the one hand, it is exactly what related work does, but that also means that the sequence length for the transformer would be the same as the number of characters. This can be a lot, which increases computation and memory complexity significantly. Therefore, the Charformer enables faster pre-processing of raw character inputs by dynamically tokenizing the characters into subwords, then feeding the tokenizations into a transformer and training everything jointly. So tokenizer and transformer at once. Hereby, it achieves the flexibility of other character level models, but does not blow up the sequence length because it learns a tokenizer, which reduces the sequence length on the fly. Tokenization with gradients shagaboom. Nice. So great, now that we know what happens high level, let's see under the hood. Every time the authors say character, they mean byte, because this is how they encode each character, allowing them to work with many languages, where all language characters are all encoded in this byte space. So the idea is to have your input, which is a sequence of L characters, each encoded by d-dimensional vectors, here 8-dimensional bytes. And the goal with this learned tokenization called gradient-based subword tokenization, or short GBST. So GBST is to find suitable representations of spans of characters to then pass them on together to the transformer. Here in the visualization, a vector is denoted just by x1. GBST takes the character sequence and their byte representation and forms character blocks, a little like n-grams. So first are the 1-grams, there the block size is 1. Then we have the 2-character blocks, 3-character blocks, and so on. And GBST computes a representation for each block by mean pooling the representation of each character in each block. Miss Coffee Bean, didn't we say that we want to reduce the sequence length? Now we have 4 sequences instead of 1. And by mean pooling, we lost the order of the individual characters for block sizes bigger than 1. What are we even doing? Ah, the recipe goes further. In order to avoid losing the order by mean pooling, the authors add positional embeddings, which are encoding the order of characters in the blocks. Okay, problem solved. Are we going to reduce the length now? Note that for bigger block sizes, we have fewer vectors than the number of characters, so the mean pooled representation of each block is repeated now, such that every character has 1 vector assigned to it. So here x1 equals x2, because x2 is just copied from x1 for the 2 grams, or 2 blocks. Now, the idea is to get a new, better representation for each character. One way to do it is by hard selection, by choosing 1 representation from all the 4 possibilities and to throw away the rest. But the authors proposed soft selection, by a weighted sum of all block representations. The weights here, in other words the scorings, are learned. It is the only part in this tokenizer that is learned through SGD on the task and its data. It kind of makes sense that this part is learned, unlike the other parts where mean pooling is hard-coded, because for getting sensible important scores from the vectors, they first have to be adapted to the data. So we now have a new representation for each character being the weighted sum of the block representations. So wait a minute, what just happened here? Well, in simple words, GBST basically asks, what does each character need from its fellow characters to inform its representation? And what if each other character can choose between 1 gram information, 2 gram, 3 gram, and so on? Or even better, each character has the option to do a combination of 1 gram, 2 gram information. In order to determine how much they should be combined, a transformation is learned to determine these importances. The gradient updates will tell the linear transformation responsible for computing the scores how much scoring is needed. It is almost like attention, with the only difference that each block position is uninformed about what the other positions do and how they combine things. So now, similarly to the MLP mixer or the FNET, which is the Fourier transform transformer, we have first mixed the characters among each other by neighborhood, then we mix again, but this time orthogonal to the first mixing. I honestly did not expect to find any parallel between the MLP mixer and the Charformer, but here it is. And now we have as many representations as characters. Well, not yay, because we started with L characters and their raw representations, and now we still have L character representations which are now more informed, yes. But didn't we say that we want to reduce the sequence length? Yes, we did. And this is the final step of GBST, downsampling. These new L learned character representations are downsampled again by a mean pooling operation over neighboring representations. And this is again hard-coded, not learned. The only learnable step in this GBST tokenizer is the scoring of the character n-gram representation. Wow. So is the tokenization procedure elegant? What do you think? Well, we honestly don't know. Does it have to be elegant? Mixing is all you need. The mixing does not even have to be learned, as we saw in the Fourier transform transformer and in other previous videos. Any mixing, and that's what these authors also do, often hard-coded, seems to work with transformers. So was this long road of character representation mixing worth it? Yes, it kind of was. These new representations from GBST are ready to be fed into your favorite transformers. Especially because very little aspects in GBST are learned, optimization will not waste a lot of time on the tokenizer part. Also, the tokenizer reduces the sequence length, making the transformer downstream also faster. I guess you can convince yourself on the performance of the Charformer on the tables in the paper linked below. Charformer is sometimes superior, sometimes on par with state-of-the-art character level models on Glue. Also, this approach works well in multilingual settings and also on noisy text, where hard-coded tokenization is brittle usually. This good performance is somewhat expected because now the tokenization adapts to your dataset and task while not blowing up your sequence length. And 0.1% state-of-the-art up and down is less important for Miss Coffee Bean than the flexibility of the Charformer on all the other applications rather than Glue. So yeah, I guess that this paper, even though framed differently from the MLP mixer, or the transformer replacing self-attention with convolutions, or the Fourier transform transformer, is again showing that mixing representations somehow, almost anyhow, works as long as you have a transformer-like architecture in general downstream. And yes, by this we mean that self-attention is not essential for transformers. See this video linked below for more about that. But this whole mixing, right? This reminds us of something, Miss Coffee Bean. What was it? Ah, yes, you know those times of feature engineering long gone? Now I guess it's time for mixing engineering. Cheers to that. Miss Coffee Bean, what are you doing? Miss Coffee Bean, no. I thought we were friends again. No, Miss Coffee Bean.